Stanley came into your life fairly late for in the game for him, yes?
He came into my life in 1973. So I would have been 25, so he would have been 45.
And were you expecting him to show up?
Well, it wasn't like that, actually. It was that I was in Ireland working on a film called Catholics, which was a TV film, a film for TV with Martin Sheen, Trevor Howard. You know, it was an amazing cast. And I heard that Kubrick was looking for actors for his next project and mm-hmm. didn't know what it was. And so I just got my agents to talk to the casting director and ask, you know, find out about it. And, you know, it was going to be Barry Lyndon. And originally, and so I got an appointment with to do an audition.
Mm-hmm.
And which is really smart, he sent the dialogue, the actual dialogue to be learned
mm-hmm.
beforehand. So a couple of days beforehand, and then he did that with all the actors that he auditioned. And so I learned it, and mm-hmm. I went there, and Kubrick wasn't there. He never turned up, and he was probably one of the first to use video auditions mm-hmm. in England. And I did an audition, and I came back and did another. And I had one dialogue scene in the film when I started, and ended up with a lot of dialogue scenes by the time we finished.
So did the relationship blossom naturally on the set, or did this become a...
No, I mean, on the set and off it. I mean, the thing was, Stanley, he loved talking about things,
mm-hmm.
anything, sport,
mm-hmm.
politics, anything at all. And so we just used to sit down and talk a lot. And he also did something which I thought was... I didn't think so much of it at the time, but... he actually just said, well, you know, you can wander on the set and just see what we're doing whenever you like, which is something that he didn't kind of extend to everybody, because he, as much as possible, wanted to keep the whole set clear of anybody who didn't have anything to do there,
mm-hmm.
whether they were a technician or an actor or whoever. He certainly didn't really like onlookers.
Mm-hmm.
So it was, you know, I didn't realize it at the time, but that's how it kind of started.
Did you...
Hold on a second.
Oh.
We gotta get the mic on.
Oh.
Right there, it's on your elbow.
Uh-huh.
You're opening up everything.
Oh, right. Are we gonna have to redo everything?
Okay, well, what is your hearing thinking? Are you hearing it or in the headset?
I was hearing it.
So
it's
just
a little softer. Okay. So uh-huh. We can do it again.
It will be so unnatural to do it again.
Yeah, you just plow on.
So were you... Was this what you were young enough that you had not had a huge amount of experience with film directors?
Right, I'd only made about three or four.
Yeah, and Kubrick was such a kind of legend already at that point.
Absolutely.
So was it what you expected? Was it completely a shock that it turned out that there was a kind of gentle, interested human being behind all this?
Yes, it did, in actual fact, because I'd seen 2001 when I was still at drama school, and then I saw Clockwork Orange just after I left drama school.
Mm-hmm.
And it was the first time in my life I was ever really conscious of looking at something and thinking, I want to work for that man. And I said that to the person who I was watching Clockwork Orange with. I want to mm-hmm. work for that man. And I did. For a very long time, as it happened.
So was he more fun as a director, or more for you as an actor, or was it more fun doing other stuff?
Well, first of all, as a director, he was the closest I ever came to somebody working like a theater director would, with mm-hmm. rehearsal, extended rehearsal, and repeat rehearsal, just to get it going. And mm-hmm. so that was one thing which really struck me. But he could be heaven or hell, wherever you found yourself, whether on the set or off it, or
mm-hmm.
you know, socially or anyway.
Was he a chatty director? I mean, did he tell
Could be. You mean chatty? You mean like he'd say, do this, do that,
yeah.
do it like this, don't know. No, what he would do is he'd start off, you come to the set, and he'd have, you know, a little tube that he could fix different lenses to,
mm-hmm.
and he'd say, play the scene, and play it as you think you're going to do it. Do it for real,
mm-hmm.
because that'll give me an idea of how I'm going to start and find my first shot.
Hmm.
And so you always had to do it with the intention of, you know, this is if, as if, you know, you're doing it in front of the camera that's turning over.
Mm-hmm.
So, it always started from a very high level of performance.
Right.
And then it would build from there.
So you were, Lyndon is kind of one of the great technological moments, I guess, even though it was kind of anti-technology in terms of what he was actually doing. But it's what everybody, one of the things that, that sticks out for people, and thank God it's now finally on Blu-ray, and we get to really look at it that way. Were you conscious of that? I mean, you were around the set and you were poking around.
Right.
Were you aware of it being different than other movies, that he was shooting things in ways that people had not really shot it?
Well, it's hard for me to say because I'd only made, you know, about three movies before that, and they were all quite small budget stuff. What you felt was that, you know, this wasn't going to be, you know, a couple of takes and out of here. Mm-hmm. I mean, it never was. And so that was different for me, for a start.
Mm-hmm.
And also, you know, the fact that here was somebody who, if he had, for instance, a very long tracking shot, you know, where a character comes in. For instance, you know, when I come in to challenge Redmond Barry to the duel,
mm-hmm.
he takes me from the door at the entrance of the gaming club and through a hallway, and then, and all the time, he's very close mm-hmm. on me. And the camera is on what they call a dolly, mm-hmm. a moviola dolly, so the arm goes up or down, and then he had a zoom lens on it, so it pulled back or move forward. And the thing was that all these things, plus the pace of how it was being moved, the rate of speed and everything, was so specific. It was so intricate, because as the arm raised, you had to zoom back, and it all had to be in perfect synchronization with the turn, and it had to be keeping track of me at the same time. And I'd never experienced that before, that kind of painstaking, you know, getting that moment right. And once you got it right, you do it again to get it better.
And were you? Did you feel pressure as an actor to that you were going to mess it up? And they were doing so many things.
You know,
so
never. And this is the funny thing, because when I went there, as like I said, I had one dialogue scene originally. That was one dialogue. Well, maybe one and a half, couple of lines there. But by the time we got to, I guess, middle of the time I was filming there, he actually sat me down and he just said, I'm going to keep you here for the rest of the movie and write a lot more scenes for you.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought my head was going to explode. But the beautiful thing was, you see, he never treated you, you know, he engaged me as an actor, and he expected me to do what it was he wanted me to do.
Mm-hmm.
So that was the only expectation I had from him, which was he was treating me like a pro.
Mm-hmm.
I was being paid to do this, and I was, you know, a quality, painstaking production. And why wouldn't I do my best? Why would I want to do anything else? And that was the kind of symbiosis of you know, I met his expectations, and he more. I mean, he was just from another planet.
So when you saw the film put together, was that a surprise for you, or was it so precise on the set that you knew exactly what was coming, or was it?
No, I wouldn't say you knew exactly what was coming. I knew the storyline, but you know, in those days you didn't have video playback,
right.
So you wouldn't have really known how a scene was playing out. You trusted him and his judgment. So when I actually saw the film, which I saw for the first time inside a cinema of about 2,000 people, there was press there and everything. Do you know, I never thought about anything particularly. I just sat there and watched it, and I thought, my God, this is just beautiful. It's fantastic. I had exactly the same feeling as I'd had when I watched 2001 and Clockwork Orange. I just thought, this is amazing. It's an experience. You're inside it so much that, you know.
Were you conscious of him shooting low light and all that? The lens issues.
In a way, I mean.
I guess you become more conscious of it since.
You bet. Yes, definitely. But yeah, no. You know, it was. I was very aware that he was an innovator. I knew that about him just by looking at 2001. I'd never seen a film never seen an American film or a film that was made by an American where they had the courage for the first 20 minutes not to have a single line of dialogue. Mm-hmm. That was the first thing that struck me about 2001. Mm-hmm. I thought, my God, it's been 20 minutes and there hasn't been a word. And yet, you're following the story, mm-hmm. you know? With Clockwork Orange, I just thought, you know, how bold and big the characters were. And as a student, you know, ex-student from a drama school where you're mm-hmm. taught to, you know, be in a stage, it's kind of stagey in a way too. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I loved doing theater. And I just thought how, you know, that was something else that was innovative. So when I was working on Barry Lyndon, you kind of thought, well, here's a guy who is doing stuff very different. And there was nothing else like it being made. And you hadn't seen anything. And most of the period movies you'd seen were like, you know, Tom Jones or, mm-hmm. you know, they were all rollicking restoration, you know, ho, ho, ho. This was not.
It feels almost like a response to Tom Jones on some level.
A little bit, yeah. The antidote to. Yeah. No, I enjoyed Tom Jones. Yeah. It was a fun movie. But that's what most people, and I think some people were actually expecting some kind of, you know, mm-hmm. Tom Jones kind of thing, you know, but it wasn't. It was a serious film about real people.
So as part of the inner circle, did you come to that whole thing of what people expected from a Kubrick film, which certainly was a big deal with Eyes Wide Shut at mm-hmm. the very end of it.
Right.
Is that something you were conscious of as you guys went through the process and as you saw his films sure. come out, and that people didn't know? Did he want people to not know? Was that part of the fun of it? Was that they had to discover it? Or?
Oh, I think, you know, discovering it was an important part. But, you know, I'd lie if I didn't, you know, say if I didn't, you know, the truth was that Stanley was just as, you know, he wanted his films to be successful. Mm-hmm. I mean, if his films were financially successful, that meant, you know, he got a kudos from it. It also meant that, put it bluntly, he was quite blunt about it himself. That meant more money. And what it meant was that it meant he had more power to do what he wanted to do and how he wanted to do it. So, you know, a lot of people kind of say, oh, it's, you know, movies are just an industry or what. But the fact of the matter is that a part of them are, and mm-hmm. you can't ignore it. And he didn't. And he prided himself on being a businessman every bit as much as he prided himself on being an artist.
So the mysteries of the Kubrick films and the, which we see now with the Coen brothers a lot, where mm-hmm. there's kind of this first reaction and then there's another reaction yeah. 6 months later and then a year later, yeah, it's yeah. a masterpiece for the person.
Yeah. No, absolutely. And if you knew, you know, the crap that Barry Lyndon went through originally when on its release, I mean, it was ripped to shreds by a lot of people. It really was. And he was very hurt by it. Mm. He really was. And it took him a long time to sort of get over that with that particular film. I would say right up into the early 90s, middle 90s, before he finally realized that people were beginning to say, this is a great movie.
You figured it out. I think we have to take a break.
Yeah. Okay. Is that okay?
So my understanding is that aside from Strangelove, that really none of the pictures ever did the box office that was kind of anticipated or were immediate critical successes in the way that they became in their perspective.
Full Metal Jacket did really well.
Internationally?
Internationally. Yeah. Oh, yeah. It was his most successful movie of all of them. It might not have, you know, it hasn't got the kudos that 2001 has. Or even Clockwork Orange, but you know, it was his most successful.
Was another film that's grown. I mean, I was in New York and saw it in a theater there, and it got in kind of slammed from some critics, particularly the second half, which I think took him a few years to figure out.
Right.
Because it really did. That film changed how we shoot war movies now. I mean, it was really the first one that was done in an urban environment.
That's true. That's very true. Because nearly every Vietnam. I would imagine that most of the world, by the time you'd finished seeing all the news footage when Vietnam was going on, most of the world would have thought Vietnam was just jungle. Mm-hmm. They didn't have such a thing as a town or a city.
Yeah.
And so it was. You're right. You're absolutely right.
And people do shoot movies like that now.
They do.
They change.
They do. But we were lucky because where we shot all the Vietnam sequences was in a gas plant,
mm-hmm.
which had been, you know, retired, I suppose, because they didn't need to use coal to produce it anymore. And but the happy accident was that the buildings inside that plant were designed by, you know, French architects, mm-hmm. and many of them had worked on architecture in Hue City. They were mm-hmm. both built in the 30s, mm-hmm. and, you know, and so what was also wonderful is that they said, well, they're going to build a freeway through here so you can do whatever you like with it. So we just went around and dynamited the buildings. And you could not have built a set like that.
No, it's
remarkable. Just couldn't have done, yeah.
Though it still comes down to the characters, as in all of his films.
Of course, yeah.
And the intimacy, was there a sense of that being a two-act film and that it was by design
design. No, you kind of knew that anyway because, you know, what it was part one was about how do you change, you know, a kid from, you know, kid who didn't know anything and, you know, about the world other than their town or their city or their pastimes,
mm-hmm.
you know, and how did you turn them into committed people, you know, to be killing machines? And then, you know, easy enough to do in a place in America, but when you move them to the theater where they have to be that killing machine,
mm-hmm.
that is act two. That's the hard part.
Yeah. And they have to look them in the eyes.
And
if you
can see them.
Yeah, though shoot me to me is still that mm. moment at the end.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Is still
yes,
one
yes,
of the
yes.
greatest moments in the history of cinema.
Yeah, yeah. And she was fantastic because she'd never acted ever.
Mm.
So I found her in a general audition. I saw about 300 people.
So how long was the process leading up to his later films? I mean, did you spend years on it? Did you spend?
Yeah, they got longer and longer. You know, when you think that from 2001 to Clockwork Orange was when 2001 came out in 68 and Clockwork Orange in 71.
Mm-hmm.
And then Barry Lyndon we shot in 73, 74, and it came out in 75. And then The Shining was 80.
Mm-hmm.
And then Full Metal Jacket was 87. And from Full Metal Jacket to Eyes Wide Shut, that was about, how long was it? 12 years, mm. 11, 12 years. But the thing is, you know, we always used to think 3 years to make a film with Stanley. It's a year in pre-production, you know, from when he said, this is what we're going to do.
Mm-hmm.
Probably a year shooting by the time you've finished and gone through all the insurance stops and God knows what.
Mm-hmm.
And probably a year in post-production. And it, you know, not quite that pat, but
right.
it varied a little bit. But, you know, we always used to say thank God for, you know, digital editing, because I don't know how long we would have been there on Full Metal Jacket, for instance, if we'd had to do it the old-fashioned way by, you know, hand splicing and stuff like that.
So you were on Avid that early?
It wasn't Avid. It was a thing called Montage, which
yes.
was...
Montage.
Yeah, yeah. Honestly, it was like, you know, science fiction as envisaged in 1945. You know, it was getting these huge banks of, you know, machines and 12 beta tapes running to find the random selection. And then you had another one with a big 3/4-inch tape. It was like, you know, 3/4-inch videotape as opposed to VHS. I mean, it was like a monster next to. And so, but on Avid, Eyes Wide Shut was cut on Avid, yeah.
So you were around for post on Shining?
Yeah.
So was
a little
that
bit, only a little bit.
So was that a painful experience? With all the, without the
equipment. Well, there was this thing, you know, because he'd moved house too, from a place he used to live called Abbots Mead, which was in Elstree, Boreham Wood, which is, you know, one of the filmmaking, was mm-hmm. the filmmaking town, I suppose, in England. And he moved to this much larger place. And, you know, the sort of, the saying there was, you know, at this house, no one can hear you scream, because it was set way back off the road. And once you, and it's true, once you went in there, you kind of felt the doors close behind you, you know, because you didn't know when you were going to get out on any particular day. So, yeah, but that went on through Full Metal Jacket and Eyes Wide Shut too.
So did do you if obviously your perspective is one of the closest. Do you feel like he changed over those last number of years? Do you feel like he was his isolation was a significant part of his work?
It's a little bit, you know, that gets exaggerated too. You know, I got a number of times we went, he did his own shopping. He used to go down to the supermarket. It's just that nobody knew what he looked like, so he never got bothered. You know, so he'd go out and about, but he did spend a lot of time at home because that's where we worked. And, you know, and as we worked, you know, more hours than there were in the day, you know, on a normal day. I mean, my normal working hours were never less than 14 hours, 16 hours. And you're talking 7 days a week because there was that much to do.
So that was even as this took these longer times between movies?
Well, you see, the other thing is that all the other movies were always being shown somewhere in the world. And then, you know, the video transfer days started, and then, you know, the laser disc started, and there was television releases, and then there was subtitling. We checked all the translations. It never, ever stopped. There was always a lot of work to do.
So is it exciting that the Blu-ray, his Blu-ray Rafe is now pretty much complete, since I don't think we'll ever see Fear and Desire?
No, you won't see Fear and Desire. And I think there's only Killing left. I mean, I've worked on all the
Which is being released by Criterion in August, I believe.
Oh, it is?
Yeah.
Oh, well, there you are. That's good. I'm glad to hear that. Because they, you know, we worked a little bit on... I know that I worked with the MGM people, and I did Paths of Glory and Killer's Kiss. You know, and with Warner's, what they did from the original transfers I did on DVD, you know, that gave them the clues to where it had to be, and then I'd just come in and adjust and the color for the Blu-ray, because Blu-ray, you know, in high definition, colors really pop, the primary colors. So you have to pull those back, and you have to give a film more of a nuance to get it to match where Stanley's original color timings were.
So was Lyndon particularly hard? I mean, it was the one that everybody, I think,
hard.
Was waiting to see.
Hard. I mean, in a way, but really rewarding. And what you can do now with Blu-ray and high def is you can get right inside the grain of the film. So you can see whether there's a little pink in there where it shouldn't be there, and, you know, which you might not be able to see as a picture in itself until it's gone by, you know, 24 times in a second, and you may think, oh, it looks a bit pink. But, you know, you can actually get inside the grains. It's fantastic technology. It is beautiful. And I, you know, I'm one of those people. I was a little worried because I thought, well, it'd been shot on film, and it had its own nature because of that, and it had a feeling because of that. But the Blu-ray, it's beautiful. It truly is beautiful. All of them have come out really well.
Well, it's Blu-rays have created a lot of controversy with some of the 70s films, particularly where, you know, people are fighting over what the original was meant to look like.
I know. But, you know, in the 70s, it wasn't always a good time for color stock. I mean, it was very up and down, and it was very inconsistent. And, you know, I think if you look at 70s films, sometimes, you know, when they play them on TV, you kind of think, Jesus, that bright. That, you know, and there was a lot of, you know, the thing about slow stocks, you know, slow color film, camera film, was that it meant you had to light them carefully to get the exposures to shoot them. And as color stock got faster and faster, people were having, you know, using less light because they thought, oh, that's great. You don't need so much light, and it saves time. And you get fast lenses, and that helped too. So, you know, it's very varied and up and down. When we shot Barry Lyndon, I think 50 ASA was the fastest color film you could get. And now you can, it's 800. I mean, it's so you can shoot without light almost.
So do you think if Stanley was alive today, he'd be shooting with a red camera? Or do you think he'd
be? Probably with the Arriflex, because Arriflex have got a camera now.
A digital.
And it is. I've seen some stuff, and it looks beautiful.
Do you think he would be resistant to the shift to digital, or be perfectly happy to?
No. I mean, you know, he would never. Everybody has this thing about Stanley being so modern, blah 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 blah. But never without a point. You know, I mean, if he didn't think there was a point in it, then he wasn't interested. You know, Steadicam was a revolution, you know, but Garrett Brown had brought the idea to him and asked for his comments. Mm-hmm. Ariflex used to, the camera, German camera company, used to bring their product and say, what do you think of this? I mean, mm-hmm. and so they kind of took his, not advice, but his suggestions and what was good about it or bad about it on board and redeveloped it. And they would have done the same with digital cameras. And he may have had mixed feelings, but he would not make the mistake of thinking that you had to make digital look the same as film, because right. you can't. It's a different animal. He's no good thinking that. So.
Well, it's interesting that Steven Spielberg is making his first digital movie yeah. ever mm-hmm. and actually cutting on an Avid for the first time ever.
Well, right. I mean, and I think it was only about, I don't know, 4 or 5 years ago when Scorsese cut his first film mm-hmm. digitally. It takes a little, you stick with what you know.
Yeah.
Most people are conservative, whether they're raging socialists or fascists, you know, and everyone in between. You'd like to stick with what you know.
Yeah.
And there's only a few people who sort of say, oh, great, let's try that.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's one of those things.
But it's awfully exciting to have his films now.
Yeah.
In the best way possible to see them at home.
Yeah, yeah. And
in
and
one place.
Yes, absolutely. Because, you know, it's only when you look back on the VHS, the original VHS, you compare them now to what there is. But, you know, we took as much trouble with those VHSs as we did, you know, with the film in the lab mm-hmm. for a theatrical release. So, you know, no, it's great. It really is. And he'd love it.